providentia in sui dispositione non fallitur. Te supites exoramus, ut noxia cunta submovias, et omnia nobis pro futura concedas. Per Dominum nostrum Iesum Christum, filium tuum, qui tecum vivit et regnat in unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Thank you.
Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, I need not tell you that we have reached the middle of summer. The burning heat of the sun reminds us that the sun has reached its apex. These warm summer days are also days when crops are growing in fields and fruit is ripening on vines and trees. These are days when we begin to look for fresh fruit and produce at roadside stands, when the seeds planted in the spring and the plants that sprouted begin to come to maturity. The church's sacred year unfolds God's mysterious plan of salvation, just as the solar year unfolds its seasons of planting, growth, and harvest. In this Sunday's sacred liturgy, the seventh Sunday after Pentecost, there is a remarkable coincidence, one might say, between the church's sacred year and the solar year. Just as we are able to read the times and seasons of nature, so too the church, overshadowed by the Holy Spirit, invites us to read the scriptures so as to learn and grasp the spiritual season in which we find ourselves and what that might mean for us and for our families and for our parish. Although we think of Lent as a penitential season rather than a joyful season, it is indeed a season of hope, a serious season with its own reasons for joy. For just as the earth emerges from the depths of winter, as the days grow longer and the earth's waters run anew, so too, under the guiding hand of Providence, the church enters into a new season of light and warmth and fecundity. During Lent, our souls are cultivated yet again by prayer, fasting, and almsgiving. The soil into which the seed of God's word was implanted at baptism is tilled anew. It is purified, enriched, and watered by the tears of the crucified Savior. As we undergo a 40-day penitential season, we strive wholly in God's grace to pull out the weeds of malice, to uproot sinful habits and attitudes, so as to focus our hearts in one direction, upon Christ our Redeemer, seeking not only to imitate him, but to participate more deeply in his mystery. For some, Lent is a time of preparing for baptism, a time of intense preparation for that great moment of new life when they are born anew by water and the Holy Spirit and are inserted into the death and resurrection of Christ our Savior. For most of us, Lent is a time of preparation to renew our baptismal promises, to reject Satan and sin, so as to live as God's adopted sons and daughters. All of this reaches its climax during Holy Week and Easter, when the church, the bride of Christ, enters most solemnly into the passion, death, and resurrection of her Lord, standing as it were with Mary and John beneath the foot of the cross. The church rejoices as she relives the mystery of the resurrection, experiences the wonderment of the apostles, listens attentively to the instructions of the risen Lord, rejoices in the power given her to forgive sin, looks into the heavens as Christ ascends and awaits the coming of the Holy Spirit. It is as if each year the church herself is born anew, and we along with the church. Thus, the springtime of the church. Looking back on what we have seen and heard, we can say with the Blessed Virgin Mary The Lord has done great things for us. We are glad indeed. Indeed, the Lord has done great things for us, year in and year out, for he has grafted us onto the vine, the tree of life. And now through the sacramental life of the church, his life flows into our souls, collectively and individually. Like a wise farmer, or like the owner of a vineyard or an orchard, the Lord now roams through the field of the church to see if the fruit is ripening on the trees he has planted. His blood has watered. His spirit has fertilized. The Lord is looking into our hearts, yours and mine, to see if the fruit is good, characteristic of a tree that is sound, or if the fruit is rotten, characteristic of a tree in decay. Indeed, the reading from St. Paul's letter, his epistle to the Romans, invites us to remember that in baptism, we were planted as precious fruit trees in the Lord's garden. We were to be servants of God and not of iniquity. For iniquity, as St. Paul reminds us, yields only the bitter fruit of discord and spiritual death. Now that we are set free from sin by the death and resurrection of Christ, Paul urges us to bear the good fruit of sanctification, leading to everlasting life. But what if, amid the solemnities of this sacred liturgy, any of us were to discern that we are not bearing the good fruit of the gospel? What if we were to find that our prayer has been perfunctory, or that we have become absorbed too much in the affairs of this world, or that we have been in some way presumptuous or ungrateful for all the Lord has done for us, or that spiritual lethargy has overtaken us during these lazy, hazy days of summer? In a church where once Blessed Francis Silos heard confessions, the answer is obvious. Let us allow the Lord to inspect the tree he planted by examining our consciences and by making a good, unburdening confession of our sins, and by not failing to engage in prayer, spiritual reading, mortification, and acts of charity, to feed and nourish our souls so that they will indeed produce the good fruit, the fruits of the Holy Spirit, the fruits of the sanctifier, which are love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, chastity, and self-control. Then, as the Son of Justice shines down upon us, God the Father will rejoice to see in you and me the good fruit of the gospel, a harvest of holiness. May God bless us and keep us in his love, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Omnipotente, factor in celi et terra. Amen.
saecula saeculorum. Amen. Dominus vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Oh.
omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Oremus. Precepti salutaribus moniti, et divina institutione formati, aut ebus dicere. Pater noster, qui es in cedis, sanctificetur nomen tuum, adveniat regnum tuum, fiat voluntas tua, sicut in cielo et in terra. Panem nostrum quotidianum, da nobis hodie, et dimitte nobis debita nostra, sicut et nos dimittimus debitoribus nostris, et ne nos inducas in tentationem. Per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Pax Domini sit semper vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Yeah.
nun pitiere onipotenti, beata Maria semper virgini, beata Michele arcangelo, beata Ioane Baptiste, sanctis apostolis Petro et Paolo, omnibus sanctus et divi pater, quia vocavi nimis cogitatione verbo et omne, mea culpa, mea maxima culpa. Ideo preco beata Maria semper virgine, beata Michele arcangelo, beata Ioane Baptiste, sanctus apostolos Petrum et Paulum, omnes sanctus et te, Pater, orare pro mea Dominum Deum nostrum.
Miserata vestri omnipotens Deus et emissis peccatis vestris, fiduc ad vos ad vitam aeternam. In audientiam absolutionem et remissionem peccatorum vestruorum, tribuat vobis omnipotens et misericus Dominus. Equitoli peccata mund, Domini non spic, sur intresum tectum me, se tantum vic fermo et senabitur anima me. Domini non spic, sur intresum tectum me, se tantum vic fermo et senabitur anima me. Domini non spic, sur intresum tectum me, se tantum vic fermo et senabitur anima me.
Respect, see, humility,
terminatis operatio, et a nos Christum presentatibus clementer expedia, et a ea questum recta perduca, per nominum nostrum Iesum Christum filium tuum, qui tecum vivit regnat in unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Thank you. Amen.